Scripture reading for this morning is from Hosea 6:1 through 7 and Mark 2:1 through 17. Come, let us return to the Lord. He has torn us to pieces, but he will heal us. He has injured us, but he will bind up our wounds. After 2 days he will revive us. On the third day he will restore us, that we may lie in his presence. Let us acknowledge the Lord. Let us press on to acknowledge him as surely as the sun rises. He will appear. He will come to us like the winter rains, like the spring rains that water the earth. What can I do with you, Ephraim? What can I do with you, Judah? Your love is like the morning mist, like the early dew that it disappears. Therefore I cut you in pieces with my prophets. I kill you with the words of my mouth. Then my judgments go forth like the sun. For I desire mercy, not sacrifice, and acknowledgement of God rather than burnt offerings. As of Adam, they have broken the covenant. They were unfaithful to me there. Mark 2:1 through 17. A few days later, when Jesus again entered Caphernaum, the people heard that he had come home. They gathered in such large numbers that there was no room left, not even the outside door, and he preached the word to them. Some men came bringing him to him a paralyzed man, carried by four of them. Since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus by digging through it. Then lowered the mat the man was lying on. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now some teachers of the law were sitting there, thinking to themselves, "Why does this fellow hold like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" Immediately Jesus knew in his spirit that this was what they were thinking in their hearts, and he said to them, "Why are you thinking these things? Which is easier to say to this paralyzed man?" "Your sins are forgiven," but to say, "Get up, take your mat, and walk." "I want you to know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins." So he said to the man, "I tell you, take up that mat, get up and take your mat and go home." He got up, took his mat, and walked out in full view of them all. Now this amazed everyone, and they praised God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this." Jesus calls Levi and eats with sinners. Once again, Jesus went outside the lake. A large crowd came to him, and he began to teach them. As he walked along, he saw Levi, son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax collector's booth, following. Jesus took him, and Levi got up and followed him. While Jesus was having dinner at Levi's house, many tax collectors and sinners were sitting with him and his disciples, for there were many who followed him. When the teachers of the law, who were Pharisees, saw him eat with the sinners and tax collectors, they asked his disciples, "Why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners?" On hearing this, Jesus said to them, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have come to call the righteous, but the sinners." May the Lord add his blessing to the reading.
Good morning.
Here we meet Jesus again. Hot on the heels of this stunning activity in Capernaum, which we discussed last week, he forgave and he healed a paralyzed man. He made the scribe's eyes bug out with frustrated fury and his daring. Now we see Jesus again. Jesus went out again beside the sea. Once again, Mark offers us Jesus on the move. So many stories in this gospel happen during a nice, long walk. But with the frenzied immediacy that speaks to a laser-like focus, a march with a purpose. Everything Jesus does, he does immediately. He does out and about. In the towns, in the fields, at the shore, there's no escaping a Jesus who's on the move. And make no mistake, Jesus is on the move. He was on the move then. He's been on the move for 2,000 years and counting. He's on the move this very moment. Yet for a church called to be the earthly presence of Jesus, joined to him as a body is inseparable from a head. We don't go for many strolls by the sea, do we? We don't breathe the fresh air. We don't speak the word of God over the rushing of the wind. We don't tread the dust of the open road beneath our feet. To look at the American church today, you'd easily think that the body of Christ had a bad run-in with Medusa. We're calcified, petrified, turned to stone, reduced to a statue, having a bodily shape, the form of godliness, but without the living power to animate it and give it its motion. How very unlike Jesus to be a tame and motionless body, still as the grave, that Jesus was far too lively to be held. And how blessedly unsettling it is when we finally get a glimpse of a church that is, like Jesus, once more on the move. If the church would thaw from her stony stability, if the church were melted into motion by a spirit like fire from heaven, then we would know the truth like new. There is no escaping a Jesus who's on the move. Out on the move. Out by the sea where he called four men to join him in snaring people in kingdom nets. It's no surprise to find the crowd tracking Jesus down. It's no surprise to hear Jesus talking to the crowd, and he taught them. Even now that he has a cluster of disciples, his words are not reserved for the select few. He isn't some mystical teacher who explains the kingdom only to the inner circle. The words of Jesus are available openly to the masses. They are not locked away secretly in a temple. They are not written down in a sealed book. They are not whispered in hushed tones around a campfire. They are not sold for a fee. His words are freely for each and every man, woman, and child in those crowds. Did he pause for a while to give them a lecture? Did the crowd walk behind him, around him, beside him as he pressed forward on his way? Well, I don't know. The crowds would not hold Jesus up, not forever. He ministered to them, and he kept on the move. He passed by the place where he had been. He went all the way to the local toll booth, the tax checkpoint, where Mark introduced us to a man named Levi, also known as Matthew. Now, Levi was a tax collector. He had a booth all his own, sitting there with book and pen. Now, even today, you probably would not think to invite the man who audits you to come to your birthday party, would you? The IRS is not popular, not least in the wake of the latest scandals. But the Roman tax system was yet more corrupt. What's worse, the tax agents often were collecting on behalf of foreign power. Now this tax collector, he's got a name like Levi. You'd think maybe he might be a Levite, someone traditionally responsible for collecting the tithes for God's kingdom. Yet here he sits, collecting not tithes, but Caesar's taxes, on behalf of a phony king like Herod, whose brutal rule was backed up by the fearsome force of pagan Rome. Levi grew up hearing the word of God. He went to Sunday school. He was a regular in church in the days of his youth, but he doesn't live it now. That's a familiar story. He doesn't live it now. From the standpoint of Jewish society, to the religious leaders and the average man on the street, anyone like Levi who worked in tax collection was a traitor, a coward, a scoundrel, an informant, a snitch, and an oppressor. Under the tax system used in Galilee at the time, a tax collector would buy the right to collect taxes for a certain region, and there are plenty of kinds of taxes to be collected. They'd often pay the whole area's taxes in advance to the governing authorities and then spend the rest of the year recovering their losses. And if they overcharged people enough, then they could earn a hefty profit from it. Some tax collectors would use violence and intimidation to make sure they won out. We know in some places, tax collectors actually use torture and murder to find tax fugitives. And they doled out beatings to family members to get them to pay up. They were less like the modern IRS, more like the mob, more like a gang. So 2 decades before Jesus started his ministry, there was a man named Judas. Common name then. Judas came from Gamala, a fort 7 miles from Capernaum. Judas led the entire region in an armed uprising against the taxpayer. He led a revolt of angry taxpayers. It was the Boston Tea Party, except it was the Gamala Tea Party. Even not counting the added extortion by tax collectors, the tax burden, even for the poor, could be over 30% of everything you have. It's no wonder everyone hated tax collectors. They got rich at the expense of everyone and everything around them. The rabbis grouped tax collectors with thieves and murderers. They said the touch of a tax collector was like the touch of a leper. It could make a whole house unclean. A tax collector's family was disgraced. He could not give testimony in a Jewish court. He couldn't belong to the synagogue. All his wealth was treated like blood money. He couldn't even give charity. He was a social pariah. He was an outcast. Both major schools of Pharisaic thought said there was nothing wrong with lying to a tax collector. They didn't deserve the truth. That's the life Levi had chosen. That's how he spent his days, hour by hour. He's probably the man whom local fishermen like Zebedee had to buy their fishing leases. He probably had his booth set up next to a main route near Capernaum. He probably stopped and searched the belongings of every traveler, confiscating his chosen amount of hired muscle nearby. What led him down that kind of road? What brought him to that kind of life? He chose a life that led to being sneered at as a traitor, a puppet of monsters. You've met him in every action movie that pits a hero against an evil corporation. Levi is the nameless, faceless bureaucrat who gets mowed down by the protagonist's bullets without a moment's thought. He's just a cog in a machine, an ordinary man caught up in the banality of evil. He may not like Rome, he may not like Herod, but he has a job to do, don't you understand? He doesn't have time to see people. He sees numbers. His motto is, it's nothing personal. It's just business. And when people look at Levi, and countless Levi's today, they also see not a person, but either a demon or a statistic. That's the way our world works too. We feel safe venting our outrage against everything nameless, faceless, anonymous. Our culture turns multinational corporations into vast human machines. So we forget every decision comes from some man or woman with a name, a face, a favorite food, a memory of falling in love for the first time, and a feud with a neighbor, and above all, fears and joys and pleasures and hurts and a desperate need for salvation. We joke with our government. Well, the government did this. The government did that. But every senator, every judge, every governor, every president, every aide and congressional staffer is a person made in God's image and meant for a glory greater than any nation. And so too, we hear news from around the world. A terrorist group kidnapped this many villagers. A drone strike killed so many terrorists. But every villager and every militant is a particular human being who has all those things. All those fears, all those joys, all those hobbies. Every one of them is a person with a story that was originally written to showcase the boundless mercy of our God. They are not nameless unless we choose not to know their names. Jesus, unlike so many around him, looks for the story. Jesus could have walked past the booth the same way we go through lines at the DMV. He could have gone the same way we pass a cash register or a panhandle. He could have seen just a tax collector, a label. Jesus didn't do that. Jesus did not see a tax collector. He saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus. He saw a man with a history. He saw a man with baggage. He saw a man with hardships and friendships all his own. A man with hopes and joys and fears and sins like anyone and everyone else. Jesus did not speak to an it. Jesus spoke to a him. And what he said was, "Follow me." Jesus came, the herald of God's kingdom, the emperor of God's empire. And Emperor Jesus handed down a decree, "You're coming with me." Levi did not say no. Levi did not try to refuse. Levi left his booth. He quit his job. He broke free from the bureaucracy. He left the red tape sitting in a heap all by itself. Faced with the seemingly mindless daily grind, the repetition of patterns for weeks and months, years and decades, it's easy to despair in the face of monotony. If Levi ever wondered if there might just be more to this life, he knew then and there in that moment that something more to life was looking him square in the eye and calling him. Levi got up, left everything, and followed him. Jesus called him to be a disciple, a future teacher and trainer. Now, if the crowd hadn't already drifted off to the next pastime, seeing Jesus summon a tax collector would have done the trick. But don't you find that just when we think Jesus is making us way too uncomfortable, he finds a way to ratchet it up a level? I know I do. And that's what happens here. The very next verse finds him at Levi's house, and so are his disciples, however many there are by now. But they aren't alone, and it isn't just a family dinner. Luke makes clear it's a great banquet. Mark agrees, they aren't just sitting at a table. They're reclining. They're feasting. They're having a party together. And Levi has brought his co-workers home with him. And then we find a large crowd of tax collectors and sinners. These are the sort of people the Psalms called the wicked and told you to stay away from for your own health. They're there in abundance. They're mingled with the Jesus crew, meeting each other not as stereotypes, but as flesh and blood people. These sinners they're called, were the only kind of friends Levi had. A closed club of misfits, the unwanted, the perpetually avoided, the wrongdoers. But Jesus and his disciples want their company. Now, needless to say, not everyone's happy with that arrangement. The local scribes belong to the Jewish sect called the Pharisees. This is the first time Mark names them. And these scribal Pharisees are mighty concerned. To a Pharisee, the fundamental purpose of a holy life is making distinctions. These people are living rightly, those people are living wrongly. These people are acceptable, those people are not acceptable. And to eat with someone, sharing the same food, was to say that you accept and welcome them. To sit down at the same table was to say, I approve of you, I welcome you, I call you a friend. The Pharisees recognized the power that had, and they insisted the purity of one's dinner company be carefully guarded. You want to have a dinner party, you seek out the local scholars. You look for respectable citizens. You don't go slumming it with ruffians and rednecks, much less crooks and creeps. But Jesus does not see just crooks and creeps. He sees the sick. He sees the needy. He sees people who have a need to be welcomed, people who need a holy friend. When Jesus calls Levi, Levi leaves everything, sort of. Levi now lives in two worlds, and he does the only thing that makes sense after meeting Jesus. He gives Jesus his other world. He brings them into collision. The world of tax collectors, ne'er-do-wells, sinners, meets the world of God's kingdom. Levi knows that his friends need Jesus, and he arranges for them to meet Jesus at a party. The wording in Mark suggests that it may have had a powerful impact. Many followed. Does that mean that out of this gathered crowd of tax collectors and sinners, a bunch of them actually became followers of Jesus? Not just Levi, but the others became disciples too? If so, is this the moment when many of the other apostles join up with Jesus? Entire groups of apostles, one because Levi had the guts to bring two worlds together? Think about that. You know, most American Christians today aren't equipped to do what Levi did. There are exceptions. I'm led to think of our friend Gary Carter and his motorcycle ministry, which is a beautiful imitation of Levi's witness. But most of us aren't like that. They say within 2 years after becoming a Christian, the average new believer no longer has serious contact with any non-Christian friends. A couple years ago, this statistic came out. 1 in 5 non-Christians in North America does not personally know even one Christian. If you take out the non-Christians who used to be involved in a church but drifted away, that figure shoots up to 3 out of every 5. 60%, a majority of those who have never known Jesus, living here right in North America, do not personally know any Christians. They don't know any of us because we choose not to know them. We choose not to meet them. We choose not to pitch our tents among them like Jesus pitched his tent on earth among sinners, poor and needy, weak and wounded, sick and sore. And if we don't do something about that, we can never be like Levi. And yet we can't go looking for friends just in order to lead them to Jesus. That's treating people like a project. That's treating them like a means to an end. That's using them to put another notch in our evangelistic belts. If we do that, then we aren't seeing them like Jesus saw Levi. We aren't seeing them as people. Levi didn't see the other tax collectors as projects. He saw them as friends. He saw them as loved ones. They were the whole world to him until Jesus cracked his world wide open. He was so keenly aware of his own need that he did not hesitate to see their needs with open eyes. And yet, barely aware of the Word of God himself, he didn't feel the pressure to evangelize on his own. All he had to do was make sure that his needy friends and the Jesus crew were in the same place at the same time. All he did was arrange the meet. And Jesus, Simon, Andrew, James, and John took it from there. Can we just do that? Can we at least manage that? In the church today, we will gladly give lip service to sharing Jesus with people. But when we see someone doing what Jesus does here, our inner Pharisee can easily creep out. I mean, to mingle with sinners and not disavow them, to not trumpet in a loud voice that we stand apart from them, isn't that compromising? Doesn't that defile us? Doesn't bad company ruin good character? If we become friends with the drunks, or the addicts, or the vandals, or the people marching in pride parades, won't that corrupt our spiritual life and ruin our witness? That's what the Pharisees want to know. That's what they're asking. How can you do this? But how does Jesus react to the Pharisees' logic? He tells them if they knew Scripture better, if they really had it in their hearts and their minds, they'd have a better glimpse of what's in God's heart and mind. As the gospel, based on Matthew's own memory, makes clear, Jesus quotes the prophet Hosea, "I desire mercy, not sacrifice." Hosea was challenging the corrupt religious and civil authorities who dealt faithlessly with the Lord. Through him, God promised judgment until people turned back to him, acknowledging their guilt and seeking his face. To the Pharisees, this is the core of their message. Before Israel can see the kingdom, before God will send his favor to them again and drive off their pagan overlords, the sinners in Israel, all those who break the law even a little bit, have to make themselves pure. But to Jesus, Hosea's message reads differently. God has a higher priority than purity, a higher priority than the sacrifice in the temple, a higher priority than precise legalism. God is not merely looking for us to give him the best, the brightest, the cleanest we've got, everything the Pharisees were ready and eager to offer. God doesn't want burnt offerings half so much as he wants people to know him, really know him, encounter him in the gritty places in life. God doesn't want sacrificial purity. He wants people to imitate his mercy. And to be merciful isn't to hold sinners and tax collectors at arm's length. It's to embrace them. It's to show them the kingdom of God is about grace that changes lives. And grace does change lives. It doesn't leave them the same. That's what the Pharisees miss. The Pharisees think, unless we build walls up front, unless we front-load our words and works with disclaimers, we'll compromise ourselves in the mess we bring. They think unless we keep our social distance, we will lose our moral distance and slide down toward the lowest common denominator. That's the road they thought Jesus was on, and it's the road a lot of modern Christians fear most. We easily think if we socialize with those loud and obnoxious sinners, the God-haters, God-deniers, and God-twisters, if we don't preach at them first thing, we've compromised the message, we've failed to take a stand. Jesus says that's the wrong way to think about it. The grace of God does not mean compromise. Jesus goes. Jesus parties with tax collectors and sinners. He makes friends with them. He doesn't deny their sinners. He doesn't deny they need mercy from God. It's the sick who need a doctor, and it's sinners who need him, he says. Luke makes it extra clear, I have come not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. In the very midst of socializing with sinners, Jesus doesn't compromise. He accepts them as people. He views them with God's eyes and holds them with God's arms, and he shows them a better way, not by preaching at them, by gently guiding them, and by showing them his own life. None of the Gospels tell us exactly what Jesus did or said at that dinner party. But he and his disciples taught and illustrated exactly what Paul said. The kingdom of God is not food and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. Joy enough to go to a party. To avoid compromise, we don't have to take a stand. We can sit down. We can recline at the table and sincerely listen to people's stories. And when the time's right, we can speak God's wisdom into everyday life. Can we see God's wisdom offering hope and truth for the practical concerns of our coworkers, our neighbors, the people in the rough part of town? Many years ago, the Welsh mountain, not far from here, was notorious for being full of the kind of characters who populated this dinner party long ago. The newspapers spoke of the gang of desperados who infest the Welsh mountains. The newspaper said many residents of the mountain often figured in the criminal courts, charged with high crimes. Even the New York Times said that our very own Welsh mountain was, and I quote, the home of people ignorant of God and Christianity, with thievery and outlawry generally their principal vocations, and an utter disregard of law marking their daily life. That was the Welsh mountain. In the days the Buzzard Gang ran wild, in the days of shacks and dugouts and shanties, the Welsh mountain was littered with sinners, the dangerous crowd, the crowd the Pharisees wanted nothing to do with. The Welsh mountain was not the kind of place you wanted to go, but someone did go there. There was a missionary named Melford Hagman, who spent 50 of the 70 years of his life taking up work among what even his obituary called as devilish a crew as ever held the fort in any facet. Reverend Hagler, it said, was fearless. He labored to help the shanty dwellers build respectable homes. He taught them to read and write. He organized schools. He put Bibles in their homes. He preached the Ten Commandments and the need to follow Jesus. Melford Hagler knew what Levi knew, and he did as Jesus did. His great-grandson sits among us today. We here and now need to recover the fearlessness of Jesus. We need to regain the love of Levi. We need to regain the missionary zeal of Melford Hagman. We need to bring a party to the IRS. Not just stay safe in these sanctified walls, but bring the holiness of God out where the people are. The more they're broken, the more they're in need. We've been broken. We know the need. We can't judge. That's not what we're sent to do. We're sent to go be a friend like Jesus was a friend. And to show that God's kingdom is something more to life. It's a new life. We need to admit that no one, not a single person, not Levi, not the Buzzard King, no one is beyond the reach of God's grace. No one can be expected to jump over our hurdles before Jesus will welcome them with open arms. We cannot afford to be afraid. We cannot afford to just lament what the world is coming to. The world, we said, We read the news and we look out and see a nameless, faceless mob. We look at them the way everyone but Jesus looked at Levi. Jesus did not come to call good people, nor did Jesus come to make us nice and decent and safe. Jesus is not looking for our conventional piety, our domesticated rituals, our mere attendance record. Jesus is looking for a reflection of the mercy and the hospitality of his Father. He's looking for us to make him unavoidable, even in the tough crowds. But we cannot do that sitting in our pews. May God show us where the need is. May God show us where the sick need doctoring and the sinful need saving. May God send us among them to be merciful as God is merciful. May we be, like Jesus, on the move. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's pray. Oh Father, you sent the Son. And as you sent the Son, so the Son sends us to go. Not to people like us. Not to people who are merely respect, but to everyone, high and low, everyone, to be a friend, to listen, and to be your wisdom and mercy wherever they are, to show all people to you, and not just to scream in the streets. Thank you, God, for all that you have done, all that you are, everything you've done for us. You have given us the grace of God when we were a rough and tumble people. As your servant Paul called us, we were children of wrath. And yet even when we were still sinners, Christ Jesus died for us. We can't grasp how big that is. How amazing that is. But let our lives not be stationary. Let them not waste away in the night. Show us how to live the kingdom. Show us how to be at lunch with Levi. And how to bring others to your table. God, we are so in love. Let us show that love and mercy to everyone as we go forth in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.